The third or okay, this is the I think third times, you know, of invitation for me to speak through Zoom while I'm here. I remember the first one I was asked to speak at 9 o'clock Bandung time, while in here the Salat Subuh is at 5:30. So 9 o'clock is 6 o'clock here. So what I did is Assalamualaikum twice, once to God and once to the participant of the seminar. But students, I hope you will have similar experience in the future, like your guru, all of them. Ibu Chlorine has already been abroad also, not only schooling, but also participating in seminars or conference probably. And I myself, Ibu Chlorine knows, you know, my feet is always running from one place to another at a different, how do you call it, different measurement, you know, and then on which side of the road and everything. So it was a good experience, especially when you are studying international law. Okay, I just would like to remind you what the various maritime zones, according to the 1982 United Nations Convention on the Law of the Sea. Does anybody present now is willing to explain to me what is this map? Can anybody? Ibu Chlorine can indicate any name because it doesn't show all here.
Oh, okay. Yes, please, anyone. Tobias, maybe you can explain Betty about this.
Which one is Tobias?
Tobias?
Tobias, are you present?
Yes, I am okay. Present.
Yeah. Can you explain what this map is about?
So the map that is present right now that I'm seeing is more or less baselines related towards the regulations relating to a territorial sea and contiguous zone. This baselines is actually used to draw the lines and explains the territorials of certain states of how long their apa ya bahasanya? I forgot. Sorry.
You are welcome to use bahasa Indonesia.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know. I'm actually kind of nervous, maybe, but yeah, I don't even remember what's the language in Indonesia. I don't know why.
Okay, you want to speak English? It's okay, but no French because I don't speak any French. Okay.
Tobias get nervous because he speaks to a professor. A very prominent
I think I have to pass for now. Maybe Noval.
Okay.
You don't want to continue? Anybody else? Where is Nova?
Nova, you will take to try.
Yes, it's me.
Where is Nova?
So.
Okay. Nova, okay. Very Arabic. Sorry. go ahead.
All right, thank you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, okay, I can listen to you. Your name is Noval Faiz M. I don't know what M is.
M stands for Muhammad. All right, thank Ahmed. You.
Okay, go ahead. Can you explain this map here that I showed to you?
So this map, it's maritime zones under the UNCLOS 1982. Mm-hmm. And as we can see, there are several maritime zones there. For example, there are territorial sea, which is from 20 nautical miles from the baselines. And then there are also exclusive economic zone. It is about 200 miles from the baselines. And there is also contiguous zone, which is more than 12 nautical miles from the baseline. So basically, it's all come from the baseline, and it is already regulated under the UNCLOS. Mm-hmm. And of course, apart from all maritime zones, there are also high seas, which is more than 200 nautical miles, and there is no sovereignty or sovereign like in the high seas. Maybe that's all from me. Thank you.
Can I ask you one question? You were explaining to me about the contiguous zone. I'm trying to explain to you today. You said that it is 24 nautical miles from the baseline. Which baseline is it? Which baseline?
All right. So as far as I know, the contiguous zone, it's being used from the normal baseline, and it has functioned in order to keep the territorial sea of the state from any kind of maybe the potential crime that might be happened. So
my question is, yeah, you mentioned 24 nautical miles, the maximum distance, okay? Now, my question is, which baseline is used to measure 24 nautical miles?
As far as I know, maybe correct me if I'm wrong. So the baseline is used, it's like the normal baselines under UNCLOS.
Okay, not too descriptive, I would say. You should mention that it is from the same baselines that you measured the territorial sea. So it can be normal, it can be any other type of baseline. Do you know any other than normal? The type of baseline? Yeah.
For example, there is also like an archipelagic baseline, if I'm not mistaken. And then also like the bay baseline, or maybe in Bahasa it's like a garis penutup teluk. It is also like the baseline, if I'm not mistaken. Also,
excuse me, what do you mean garis penutup in here for the baseline? Is there any such things, garis penutup, or the closing line in English?
I'm sorry, but I forgot the terms in English. I don't.
Okay, well, that is how Ibu Eti teach, you know. Every time, if I have to come every week, I always come with questions. I wanted to know whether the previous docent, like I believe it's Dr. Guzman, the previous ones, has already explained to you in details, a good descriptions about the various type of baseline. And even though it is called just baselines, but there are means, you know, of drawing the baseline differently. You mentioned the archipelagic baseline. You should use archipelagic straight baseline as it is written in 1982 UNCLOS. But as we do, we also combine it with the normal baseline. Okay? Does it explain to any other students? Any question? So everybody understand it? Because you really have to understand, you know, the drawing of baselines. Once when you graduated from the school and you were put into some kind of a work that deals with the baseline, be it in economic, be it in geology, be it in anything else, you have to understand that. This is the one that really bring to quite a lot of a discussion, especially when you remember we just officially put up Professor Muhtar Kusuma Atmaja Long Street, the Pasupati Ambassador Ridwan Kamil try to explain what is the fight of Pak Muhtar at that time. The fight is what Noval had mentioned about archipelagic baseline, because that was not really regulated in the old law of the sea. For instance, the one that you already must know, the 1958 UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, especially on the territorial sea. Okay, you know, why I tried to have some discussion at the start of our today is that as a guru, as a docent, I always wanted to bring you to the understanding and how important it is to know the history of why a certain norm in any convention, any law, whatever, brings to the reality, so to speak. You know, like the archipelagic state baseline had difficult acceptance from many countries because we were at sometimes regarded as having been stealing some water using the archipelagic baseline. Because if you remember Ridwan Kamil's speech on that day, he said that we had an additional, what was it, 3 million square nautical miles in our water area that's becoming our territory. So that is very important for you to know what was the history of that. The history was the 17,000 islands were separated by a very short territorial sea of 3 nautical miles at that time. So if you want to go from Jakarta to Lampung, you have to cross the high seas somewhere. Not today. Today you can just cross it, how long? I don't know now. Crossing from Merak, is it? Or from wherever to Lampung? It is 1 or 2 hours. I don't know. I haven't taken that for a long time. Okay. So this is the various maritime zone only shows that according to the agreement of more than how many now? I think 170 or 180 countries in the world, they agreed to divide the sea into different kind of regulation. The first one is the territorial sea, for instance, that is the full sovereignty, except full is between quotation, because underneath there is also the obligation of those who have the territorial sea to accommodate navigation by foreign fishermen. For instance, it's already in thought, I think, by Pak Guzman, the Innocent Passage. Are you familiar with that? Who will answer to me? What is the name? Fatia Kulsum?
Yes. Mungkin saya nyampaikan dalam bahasa Indonesia. Kalau Innocent Passage boleh. Itu sebenarnya yang saya pelajari dulu di perkenalkan dulu, Bu. Saya kebetulan mahasiswa S2.
Mahasiswa S2? Good. Yeah. Okay, bagus.
Karena kebetulan mahasiswanya cuma ada satu untuk kelas contemporary issue on the law of the sea. Jadi diikutkan dalam prodi S1. Kalau Innocent Passage itu sebenarnya yang saya pelajari dulu tuh terkait dengan garis apa lintas batas damai, melewati kapal dapat melewati secara damai dalam suatu wilayah laut, kurang lebihnya seperti itu, Bu.
Okay, that is good for you, you know, to join the S1 class because I believe Pak Guzman has already explain to you how Innocent Passage was born, bagaimana itu lahir ke dalam hukum internasional. Karena sebetulnya itu sudah ada dari zaman 30-an juga lah ya, tapi beda peraturannya. Kalau sekarang ada peraturannya, dan di dalam undang-undang Indonesia juga sudah ada aturan tentang Innocent Passage ini, yang nanti kalau Anda S2 kalau mau nulis tesis tentang ini mungkin perlu diperhatikan. Apakah peraturan tentang lintas damai itu sudah sesuai dengan apa yang terjadi ketika pembentukannya di Konvensi Hukum Laut tahun 82. Sorry, I'm not your promoter. I'm only give you some indication. Yeah. Okay. So these are the various maritime zones that has been divided on those who are called the national territories. Some of them are under national jurisdiction, it is not part of the territory, and some others are called those areas of the sea be it the water column or also the seabed and subsoil thereof, that the every country only has the sovereign rights for the resources. And according to some rules within the 1982 UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, within such sovereign rights, there might be also some implication or maybe some necessary to also use the national laws and regulation. Yeah. And then like Noval just said, the high seas is not part of any sovereignty of anybody, except when you are on a vessel, on a ship, and you fly, for instance, the red and white, the Indonesian, then you, that ship is under the territory of the Indonesia. Can you understand that? Or if Bu Eti is taking you into confusion? Noval is nodding. I don't know. I hope Ibu Fatia also would understand that. Okay. Now, I'm sorry. Okay. Now, I just told you that the division of the sea by the 1982 UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, which is also originated by some of the 1958 UN Convention on different zones of the law of the sea, like the territorial sea and then the continental shelf and the high seas and others are the use of the ocean. Now, on the 1982 Convention on the Law of the Sea, there was born a new zone that was not recognized before, that was not accepted before as part of international law, which is called the exclusive economic zone. Now, how was it born, actually? Again, this is the history. In order to know, to understand exclusive economic zone, you also have to go back to how it was born. But I think I'm too quick in moving my slides. Let me see. Okay, I'm right. Sorry, how do I do it? There. Okay, so I was telling you that the part of the ocean is also called some part where the states have sovereign rights over natural resources. Is there anybody else beside Fatia and Noval? Is there anybody else? Or Norin?
Yes, we have, maybe I can call Safa, Arifania Safa.
Arifania Safa, can you explain what does sovereign rights over natural resources is? How does it regulate it by the 1982 convention?
Firstly, I would like to say thank you for the opportunity. As far as I know about the sovereign rights, it is called hak berdaulat in Indonesia, and it's about rights that it's about a right that yang dipunyai oleh coastal state after the territorial zone, if I'm not wrong. So maybe right there.
In a territorial zone, do we have sovereign rights or sovereignty? Which one do we have over natural resources?
As far as I know, we have sovereignty.
Sovereignty, okay. So what is the difference between sovereign rights and sovereignty?
So from the previous lecture, I find out that the differences between the sovereign rights and sovereignty is that sovereignty is like a full rights from the coastal state that they can do anything in that zones, and they so that it calls sovereignty, so they can have berdaulat secara penuh. But in sovereign rights, As far as I know, in Sovereign Rights, the coastal state, the coastal state tidak punya hak sebanyak itu gitu Bu, untuk tidak seperti di sovereignty gitu. Tapi harus mempertimbangkan juga hak-hak negara-negara lain yang ada di sekitarnya. Mungkin.
Okay. A good response from I cannot read it. Arifania. Okay. Am I right in reading your name?
Arifania. Yes,
yeah, okay. So Arifania was trying to make a difference between sovereignty and sovereign rights, saying that in sovereign rights areas, you don't have that many, not only rights in sovereignty, actually, it is the ownership of all the natural resources that are in there, except, now, again, you go to the history. When you speak about regulation over natural resources, you also have to look at the environment and how the natural resources is developed. That would put you into the obligation under environmental regulation. For instance, for fisheries is different compared with other natural resources that you can find on the sea. Okay? Okay. A good discussion for the first class. How many students, Odin, do you have here?
Oh, we have 13.
14, oh, small, good for discussion.
Yeah.
Okay, so this is the sovereign rights over natural resources. We have two zones, which is called the exclusive economic zone, that is the water column. And then beneath it, there is the seabed and the subsoil. It is called the continental shelf. In Bahasa Indonesia, it's landas kontinen, right? This is very important for you to understand the terminology, especially the legal terminology, because from my own experience working with some people in our own government, they are still confusing about understanding what is a landas kontinen. When I was studying law of the sea, I had some difficulties in understanding landas kontinen too. Fortunately enough, I studied in Bandung at UNPAD, and the neighbor of UNPAD is ITB. So I got some friends from geology and all those things. I tried to ask them, what is actually is a landas kontinen? It is very different than what is regulated under 1982 convention, because they were only defining it in the understanding of geology. While in the 1982 convention, they have some kind of regulation that indicates the length and the depth of the subsoil and the seabed. Okay, I guess I will have to go here again. You have the another map that is very descriptive here, because it also indicates, beside only the territorial sea, the contiguous zone, the what do you call it, the continental shelf and the exclusive economic zone, there are various geological terminologies that you can see in the seabed. Beside the continental shelf, that is also what is called the continental slope, continental rise, and then the deep seabed. That is geology, in the meaning of geology. It doesn't indicate it actually, all this geological terminology, in the regulation under 1982 convention. But however, you should know all this, because when you work in this field, some people that have the knowledge of geology would indicate, where does it lie? Is it within the shelf itself, or does it also include the slope, the rise, and go all the way to the deep seabed? That is very important. Why I indicate certain times ago to Pak Guzman that perhaps this is for Ibu Orin to think also, in the law school, we should have the mata kuliah hukum laut is also cooperate with other science that is important for the law of the sea. For instance, biology, you speak about fish, about and anything that deals with the natural resources, and then with geology, with mining and everything. Because you will only understand the 1982 Convention on the Law of the Sea when it speak about all these science things, when you know what that science is. It is not easy. I called my friends at ITB several times, and they said this Eti Agus is too much, calling us not only to go for dating, but to question about the science that we are studying at ITB. But that is very important, because now I see that some of our, pejabat, yeah, the official in Jakarta, did not understand where in the sea do we have full sovereignty, or do we have sovereign rights, like Arifania mentioned, and then where we actually have the right to it, but we don't have any sovereignty or sovereign rights. Probably this hasn't been taught, yeah, for you, the international seabed area. Maybe I give you the knowledge about the contiguous zone and the exclusive economic zone. However, that is very important. I see some differences, at least in our country, for people when trying to draw a certain law of implementation. Most of them did not understand the difference between sovereignty and sovereign rights. Did not understand between the rights that is given to any country in the world for the seabed and everything. Because once I was very, very shocking, so to speak, but I didn't yell. I was just very, very shocking, because one of our pejabat said that we have sovereignty over the international seabed area. So we have to really keep our full sovereignty there. Then I don't blame him. I blame maybe those people who assist him in preparing this, whatever he was trying to give to the audience at that time, including myself. But I didn't say anything to him, because I didn't want to make him ashamed of it. But then I tried, like I do that today. I look at all the audience at that time, and then I noticed there was one, my former student. So I said, hey, you're from UNPAD. Can you tell me, do we have any sovereignty at the seabed? He didn't dare, because he doesn't want to speak against the pejabat. You can do that later. I'm not telling you to do something that is not good, okay? This is only some of my experience, you know, when you deal with it, because myself, for instance, is very fortunate to have some ability that enable myself to learn on how it is implemented by the government. And I see how important it is to be an ex-student from UNPAD. Myself, previous students of Pamhotar Kusuma Atmaja, now you are students of Pak Gusman. Pak Gusman is also very good, his knowledge on the law of the sea. That is why I'm happy to hear from Ibu Orin that Pak Gusman has taken part in teaching you about this. Because I want to bring back the good thing about the mata kuliah hukum laut in UNPAD, so everybody will take it as a Ka'bah. We look at how it was taught at UNPAD, beside what is taught somewhere else that is not really in conformity with what was ruled by the 1982 convention. Okay, now let's go to the first zone that was given to me for today, what is called the contiguous zone. I just put this, what is indicated or what is written in Article 33, the only a provision of the 1982 convention on the contiguous zone. You don't have any other besides this. It is said that in a zone contiguous to its territorial sea, mean it's continue after the 12 nautical miles, that is the maximum distance of the territorial sea under 1982 clause. Okay, my question is, can any country decide to set up their territorial sea less than 12 miles? Okay, anybody? Can any country in this world allowable to only claim territorial sea less than 12 nautical miles under the rules of the 1982 convention? Okay, who? Yes, Joshua. What is the name here? Gregory? Okay.
Thank you so much, Professor Reti, for your opportunity. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, so actually, if we take a look at the practice of most countries, most countries have their territorial waters up to 12 miles from the baseline, as have been stipulated under the 1982
I'm sorry, Gregory, there are some sounds that is disrupting. Can you repeat again?
Yes, I'm sorry, Prof. Because I'm not in my personal room right now. Most of the country in the world are leaning to the provision under the UNCLOS 1982 that the territorial sea is up to 12 miles from their baselines. However, if we take a look again at the provision under the Article 3 of the breadth of the territorial sea, it is stipulated that every state has the right to establish the breadth of its territorial sea up to a limit not exceeding 12 nautical miles. So under the certain provision, it is allowed for countries to set the territorial sea less than 12 miles, but not more than 12 nautical miles, based on Article 3.
Okay, thank you. Very good. So you know what is the maximum, and it doesn't indicate that it's the option, not the option, the conformity that you have to follow, because that is only the maximum limit of the territorial sea that you can claim. So if you want only to claim 3 miles, it is okay. You only want to claim 10 miles, also okay. Okay, but the maximum is 12 nautical miles. This will come to the contiguous zone that we are going to study today. So if the territorial sea is less than 12 nautical miles, how would the contiguous zone measurement is? For instance, there is a certain state that only claim 9 miles of territorial sea. How far can that state claim the contiguous zone? Explain.
Okay, thank you for the opportunity. Jika merujuk pada pasal yang terdapat di PowerPoint saat ini, terlebih pada ayat 2-nya, itu dikatakan bahwa batas dari pengambilan zona tambahan atau contiguous zone ini sepanjang 24 mil. Jadi sama seperti tadi, kasus apabila sebuah negara ingin hanya mengambilnya, misalnya 3 mil saja, itu tidak apa-apa, asal tidak melebihi 24 mil tadi.
Okay, that is something, can anybody respond to that? Did Aditya has explained correctly? Seems to be, because I only have the picture of Arifania. Arifania is thinking about it. So what do you think?
I think that as far as I know that maximum zones from the baseline to the territorial sea and then the contiguous zone is 24 nautical miles. I think that the answer from Aditya Naufal is right, but I actually curious at the same time that maybe if I'm wrong that maximum zones in contiguous zones is up to 12 miles. So if there is any country that take the territorial zone less than 12 nautical miles, so maybe it's still they still have contiguous zone maximum to 12 nautical miles, and I'm actually curious about the answer, so maybe you can explain to us. Thank you.
Thank you, Arifania and Aditya. Here is where I said, you know, when you learn about the profession of legal documents, you really have to understand what does it indicate. My question was, if a country only claim 9 nautical miles of territorial sea, how far or how is the exit of the contiguous zone? It only claimed 9 miles of the territorial sea. And the law here, Article 33, paragraph 2, says contiguous zone may not extend beyond 24 nautical miles. So what does it indicate actually? You only claim 9 miles territorial sea. So how far can you claim the contiguous zone if it is only 9 miles? Anand, do you have any? Okay.
Yes. Thank you for the opportunity, Prof. Etty. As far as I know, berdasarkan dari paragraf 2 artikel 33 mengenai contiguous zone dari UNCLOS 1982, the contiguous zone may not extend beyond 24 nautical miles from the baseline. Dari yang dapat saya simpulkan dari itu, apabila misalnya suatu negara hanya mengambil 9 nautical miles untuk laut teritorialnya. Untuk berdasarkan paragraf kedua artikel 33 ini, suatu negara bebas menentukan contiguous zone-nya selama tidak melebihi batas 24 nautical miles yang telah ditentukan dalam paragraf kedua artikel ke-33 ini. Terima kasih.
Dan berarti contiguous zone-nya maksimum?
Tetap 20.
Kira-kira berapa?
Tetap 24 nautical miles.
Itu batas terluar yang bisa diklaim. Tapi kalau territorial sea-nya hanya 9 miles, contiguous zone-nya jadi
21, Ibu.
24 dikurangi 9.
15, ya, Bu.
Tuh, ya. Ini gimana ini? Law student math-nya kurang bagus kayaknya.
Ngurangin jadi alasan, salah. Bu. Nggak belajar matematika.
Kita harus tahu betul di dalam law of the sea ini, ya, mengenai math itu betul-betul harus tahu. Karena seperti ini, tadi Ibu katakannya, kalau kita membaca suatu ketentuan hukum, kita harus tahu betul what is the intention. Ya, di situ tidak dikatakan anything about territorial sea on this article, because it's already written on the previous articles before that the maximum claim for a territorial sea is 12 nautical miles. My question before, can we claim less than 12 nautical miles? And the answer is?
Yes, we can.
Yes, yes, we can claim less than 12 nautical miles. I just given to you with this kind of thinking you have to really think about. What if the territorial sea is claimed only 9 miles? It means you can continue up to the maximum limit of 24 nautical miles from the same baseline, what is called the contiguous zone. Why is it important, the math here? If the maximum limit is 24 nautical miles, if you combine the territorial sea and the contiguous zone, then if you claim only 9 miles of territorial sea, it means you can have 15 miles of contiguous zone. So you see the importance for you to understand what is the rule indicated. Yeah, we were laughing because we were not that good in math. We don't know how to take 9 miles out of 24 miles, for instance. You know, that is something you have to understand. Because in the law of the sea, you will see many of these numbers. Many of the, some kind of mathematic importance for you to read. When you speak about the exclusive economic zone later, you will see how it is very important, okay? Okay, so go back to the contiguous zones under Article 33. If you already claim the territorial sea and also the contiguous zones, what is the difference between these two zones? Arifania already mentioned that in the territorial sea, you have the full sovereignty, okay? Do we have the same thing in the contiguous zone? No, because paragraph one of this article, Article 33, indicated what is some kind of rights of a coastal state that can be applied in the contiguous zone. It is only some movement in the of the coastal state to control the ocean that is called the contiguous zone of the sea, probably you will more understand. The first one is to prevent infringement of its custom, fiscal, immigration, sanitary laws and regulation within, whether it is the territory or the territorial sea. What is the difference between the territory or territorial sea? Anand, can you explain that? What is the difference in one paragraph one of Article C, Section A? What does it mean? Why did it say within its territory or territorial sea? In here, territory here, and then here it says territorial sea.
Pardon me, ma'am. Prof, apakah bisa diulang?
Pertanyaannya, apa ya, perbedaan antara teritori dan territorial sea? Apa perbedaan antara wilayah negara dan wilayah laut teritorial atau laut wilayah zaman dulu namanya?
Ya, baik. Prof, untuk teritori itu sendiri merupakan wilayah daratan dan ya di luar perairan yang ada di negara tersebut. Sementara untuk territorial sea atau laut teritorial adalah wilayah perairan yang berada di dalam batas sejauh 12 nautical miles ataupun batas batas laut teritorial yang ditentukan oleh negara itu dari baseline seperti itu.
Nah, kalau kita lihat ya Anand, this 1A prevent infringement tentang bea cukai, aturan keuangan, aturan imigrasi, aturan saniter, ya atau kesehatan. Itu kenapa dimasukkan territory or territorial sea? Di dalam penerapannya kira-kira bagaimana? Di mana kita bisa menerapkan kalau kita punya ya peraturan tentang customs, fiscal, immigration, sanitary laws, whether this is a law or regulation, what type of regulation yang dilakukan di wilayah atau laut teritorial. Apa ini maksudnya? Anybody came up to this problem? Hah? Nggak ngerti.
Saya masih agak ngawang, Bu, mohon maaf.
Nah, makanya Ibu sudah mencoba ya untuk ya berdasarkan pengalaman Ibu lah. Ibu juga kan dulu murid kayak kalian ya. Nah, kalau Pak Mohtar dulu lebih galak dari Ibu. Kalau Ibu ngajak Anda untuk diskusikan. Kalau Pak Mohtar nanti masuk kelas timbul dengan pertanyaan anu laut teritorial adalah wilayah negara di mana kita gini-gini, tapi harus membolehkan kapal-kapal asing masuk. Apa menurut pengertianmu? Nah, kalau kita nggak bisa jawab, Pak Mohtar bilang kita tidur. Nah, hari ini Ibu nggak bisa bilang kamu tidur, udah jam 11 lebih. Ya. Kalau baru jam 8, kayak Ibu di sini mungkin masih tidur, masih ngantuk. Nah, zaman Pak Mohtar gitu. Tuh. Nah, nanti kalau tidak satu pun menjawab, Bapak nanti tunjuk. Coba jawab oleh yang duduk di belakang. Jawab, nggak dibilang benar atau enggak. Coba yang duduk di depan, jawab, nggak dibilang benar atau enggak. Lalu Pak Mohtar tanya, apa semua pada tidur sebelum kuliah? Nggak baca dulu untuk bisa mengerti apa yang akan saya ajarkan? Sorry, itu hanya satu nasihat dari Ibu pada Anda semua. Kalau sekarang jadi mahasiswa, sebelum masuk ikut kuliah itu, wah si Ibu Et ini mau apa bidangnya? Contiguous zone dan exclusive economic zone. Paling tidak baca sedikit. Anda lebih untung dari Ibu, ada internet. You can get any information from the internet, whether you understand it or not, it is understandable for Ibu. Oke? Okay? Ya, jadi Ibu tanyakan sekarang, di sini disebutkan, negara pantai dapat melaksanakan pengawasan yang penting untuk menghalangi adanya satu pelanggaran terhadap aturan-aturan the rules and regulation tentang bea cukai custom ya, tentang fiskal keuangan, ada uang palsu, uang apa masuk secara tidak legal, tentang imigrasi, orang masuk tanpa punya visa, seenaknya aja masuk ke Indonesia, gitu loh ya. Apalagi sekarang dengan pandemi. Nah, immigration lebih mudah mungkin dengan adanya aturan karantina, tapi udah dihapus sama Pak Luhut. Orang sekarang tidak usah karantina. Kemudian sanitary laws. You periksa dari kalau Anda memang sayang kucing atau sayang anjing, bawa dalam traveling. Itu tuh peraturannya kita punya. Nah, apakah orang yang masuk itu sudah bisa diperiksa sebelum masuk ke territorial sea? Artinya apa? Karena aturan ini pasal 33 itu jelas berjudul contiguous zone, zona tambahan. Jadi bukan laut teritorial. Jadi sudah bisa diperiksa di sana kalau dia lewat laut. Ya, jadi ketika kapalnya belum memasuki wilayah kebetulan Indonesia klaim 12 mil, wilayah 12 mil, petugas-petugas kita sudah bisa memeriksa hal-hal yang menunjukkan adanya indikasi pelanggaran terhadap aturan-aturan ini. Artinya apa? Tadi Arifania sudah mengatakan yang jelas full sovereignty di teritorial sea, ya, apalagi teritori gitu lah ya. Nah, ini kok di artikel 33 dari contiguous zone kita sudah bisa exercise the control necessary untuk mencegah adanya pelanggaran-pelanggaran ini. Nah, ini penting sekali ya, terutama kalau kita bicara custom dan fiskal. Itu kadang-kadang penyelundupan kan yang selalu jadi masalah kita kalau di laut itu. Barang-barang yang masuk tanpa ada surat-surat yang resmi atau bagaimana. Sampai dulu Ibu pernah agak kaget karena ada barang-barang dari kapal-kapal yang tenggelam yang ada di perairan Indonesia, karena itu mempunyai nilai budaya gitu loh ya, itu dibawa ke Australia tanpa membawa surat-surat resmi dari Indonesia. Itu Australia kemudian mempertanyakan kepada Indonesia, saya akan kembalikan barang ini karena dia masuk secara ilegal. Karena apa? Ada aturannya di Indonesia tentang benda-benda cagar budaya ini misalnya. Itu satu contoh saja ya. Mungkin tidak hanya benda itu, ada benda yang lain juga yang coba untuk dimasukkan secara ilegal, secara tidak apa mengikuti aturan hukum. Nah, di sini di contiguous zone ini pelaksanaan pengawasan itu hanya dibatasi pada masalah-masalah yang berkaitan dengan custom, fiscal, immigration, and sanitary laws and regulation. Jadi yang Ibu contohkan tadi ya, kalau bea cukai kan barang masuk tanpa mengikuti aturan ada nilai yang harus dibayar atau apa namanya pajak masuk, apa sih namanya, Ibu kurang paham ya kalau perpajakan. Kemudian fiskal, pemasukan uang palsu misalnya. Dan sekarang banyak sekali tuh di WA keluar US dollar yang dibikin melalui mesin-mesin di rumah segala macam. Kemudian immigration tidak punya visa untuk masuk ke Indonesia. Karena untuk masuk ke wilayah Indonesia itu tidak ada visa free. Ada yang dipermudah yaitu ketika masuk di bandara dia kemudian meminta visa. Ya sama dengan Ibu juga, kita dengan Oman ini belum punya apa namanya itu diplomatic cooperation atau apapun, sehingga ketika Ibu meminta visa untuk bisa masuk ke sini itu melalui internet, cari mana itunya apa namanya kantor yang resminya di Oman ini untuk saya minta atau apa namanya itu ya minta agar bisa diberi visa untuk tinggal di sini. Nah, dengan sistem itu immigration ini kalau di laut ya tadi tidak di airport ya, jelas karena kapal laut kan tidak ke airport. Sebelum masuk pelabuhan, karena pelabuhan adanya di territorial sea atau di internal waters, sudah bisa diperiksa sejak dia berada di luar batas laut teritorial. Yaitu yang tambahan tadi oleh Anan disebut 12 mil ya, sampai dengan 24 mil karena kita menganut 12 mil territorial sea. Ya tadi Anan lupa matematiknya. Ibu kasih contoh kita nganutnya 9 mil ya Anan ya. Enggak apa-apa. Jadi hari ini kamu belajar ya, di rumah punya adik atau apa yang masih belajar matematik, belajar lagi lah. Okay, sorry. I'm not trying to make you fun. Jadi itu yang pertama adalah mencegah. Prevent bahasa Inggrisnya. Yang kedua in B, punish infringement. Kalau terjadi ternyata ada satu pelanggaran, bisa menghukumnya. Kalau kejadian itu dilaksanakan atau berkaitan dengan wilayah negara atau laut wilayah negara, laut teritorial. Ya, kalau pelanggaran itu misalnya kita punya aturan tentang laut teritorial kita. Segala benda yang masuk ke wilayah Indonesia, yaitu laut teritorial yang batasnya 12 mil dari garis pangkal, maka dia harus sudah membawa surat-surat resmi pemasukan barang itu. Nah, kalau nggak ada, nah ini merupakan suatu an infringement, suatu pelanggaran. Kita bisa menggunakan peraturan perundang-undangan kita yang mungkin Anda ketika belajar dulu apa ya PIH, PTHI dan segala macam, atau mungkin di tata negara juga. Itu biasanya disebutkan kalau undang-undang nasional itu hanya berlaku di wilayah negara kan ya. Nah, sedangkan di sini hukum laut memperkenankan itu untuk diterapkan di contiguous zone. Contiguous zone itu bukan wilayah negara. Hanya satu tambahan zona maritim yang berbatasan dengan laut teritorial. Untuk apa? Pertama untuk mencegah dan kedua untuk bisa memberikan punishment apabila terjadi pelanggaran terhadap aturan-aturan yang dikeluarkan oleh Indonesia atau any states in this world yang berkaitan dengan custom, fiscal, immigration, and sanitary laws and regulation. Membingungkan atau cukup jelas? Nah, Anan kelihatannya melamun nih. Buat siapa jelas barusan? Rifyana?
Rasina, Bu. Sudah jelas, Bu.
Arifania, sorry.
Revina, salah aja nyebut.
Revina dia mana? Oh, yang bawah ini ya.
Yang bawah, Bu.
Baju hitam, jelas sudah. Ya, jadi ya, itu kalau apa-apa yang berlaku di contiguous zone menurut pasal 33. Ya, ini Ibu terapkan di sini ada satu peta yang Ibu dapat dari internet yang sebetulnya kalau menurut Ibu kurang tepat. Karena di situ lebar contiguous zone yang hanya 12 mil kalau lebih kecil dari territorial sea. tapi hampir setengahnya dari exclusive economic zone. Kan kalau itu batas terluarnya 200 mil, teritorisasinya 12 mil, maka exclusive economic zone-nya adalah 200 min 12, ya Anan ya. Tahu ya kalau sekarang jawabannya. Jadi 200 min 12, jadi kalau 12-nya itu harusnya lebih kecil dari yang sisanya. Kalau 200 dikurangi 12, sisanya adalah 188,
Ibu.
188. Jadi ini di gambar peta ini contiguous zone yang hanya 12 mil dengan 188 mil digambarkan sama, kan? Nah, ini hanya untuk memperlihatkan kepada Anda ya, kalau kita sekarang itu any information you can get through internet. But you have to understand. Ini Ibu sengaja masukkan di sini. Karena Ibu lupa ya source-nya ini dari siapa yang memasang ini. Ibu sendiri berpikir kok 12 mil lebarnya sama dengan sisa yang dari 200 min 24. Karena tadi kan teritorialnya 12, ini 12, kok disamakan gitu. Jadi apa namanya itu kalau di dalam istilah internet itu image or pictures atau apa itu kita harus agak ini. Agak apa namanya itu memahaminya dengan baik. Ya, sehingga kita bisa membuat suatu pertanyaan. How come 12 miles measurement on the picture, on the map, is almost the same as 200 minus 24? Jelasnya kan harus beda. Ya. Ini hanya memperlihatkan ini saja. Ya. Jadi ini sudah mengerti ya. The rules on the contiguous zone adalah adanya satu hak bagi negara untuk mengawasi segala sesuatu yang penting untuk mencegah adanya pelanggaran terhadap ketentuan-ketentuan hukum yang kita keluarkan melalui peraturan perundang-undangan kita yang berkaitan tadi dengan bea cukai, keuangan, imigrasi, dan hukum saniter. Ya, saniter itu biasanya kalau di kita kan berkaitan dengan hewan ya. Yang bawa anjing itu harus dibawa dengan satu apa namanya itu koper dianya yang pakai lubang-lubang. Nanti diperiksanya apa oleh karantina. Jadi kalau Anda pernah ke Bali, masuk di airport itu selalu ada corner untuk pemeriksaan karantina. Karena mungkin saja apa namanya turis yang masuk ke sana tidak mau meninggalkan anjingnya di rumah. Mau diajak juga main untuk mengenal keindahan Pulau Bali misalnya ya. Karena dulu juga Fakultas Hukum pernah ngalamin. Kami mengundang seorang dosen dari Texas kalau nggak salah ya waktu itu dari Dallas University. Profesor Barbara itu sayang sekali dengan kucing, bukan anjing. Kucing, dan dia bawa kucing itu. Ketika masuk ke Bandung itu dia tanya sama saya, aturan apa yang harus saya penuhi? Masya Allah, saya aja nggak tahu. Kucing yang ada di rumah nggak pakai aturan-aturan, nggak ada pendaftaran gitu ya ke ini apa segala macam ini dari luar negeri. Jadi saya terpaksa tanya sana, tanya sini. Ya udah dilaporkan saja ke apa namanya itu kantor kehewanan atau apa waktu itu. Satu hari kucingnya hilang. Rumahnya tuh di Jalan Hegar mana, rumah gede ya. Jadi di belakang ada benteng rumah atau apa. Rupanya si kucing dari Texas ini lihat kucing cantik dari Bandung. Dia ngejar si kucing cantik itu dan tidak pernah balik lagi ke rumah yang didiami oleh si Profesor Barbara. Dan Profesor Barbara itu nangisnya bukan main. Karena si kucing itu memang kesayangan dia gitu ya. Namanya tuh Nureyev karena dia bisa loncat seperti penari balet Nureyev dulu yang sangat terkenal. Jadi ibu juga jadi pusing ngurusin kucing. Dosen Fakultas Hukum nemenin profesor dari Texas harus ngurusin kucingnya gitu ya. Nah, ini jadi sanitary laws itu pentingnya di sini. Ya, karena banyak sekali yang bawa bahkan mungkin maaf apa ada orang-orang yang tidak hanya membawa kucing dan anjing karena kesayangan sekarang kan macam-macam ya binatang apapun. Baik ya, jadi ini the only rules, the only provision of the 1982 convention on the contiguous zone. Like we are trying to do today is that this is only two paragraph, the first one with two sub paragraph needs for us to really understand what is actually the provision of this article. Ya, jadi sekarang mengerti ya, ini ada kaitannya dengan empat macam hal yang diatur oleh peraturan perundang-undangan nasional. Bea cukai, keuangan, imigrasi, dan saniter. Ini penting sekali ya. Kalau nanti Anda misalnya kerja di apa ya, kalau ini di imigrasi atau di Departemen Keuangan, di Dirjen Pajak dan sebagainya, ini harus tahu betul. Ya. Oleh karena itu hukum laut ini bukan mata kuliah yang populer. Tetapi ya, sekarang dirasakan oleh para pejabat-pejabat di Jakarta bahwa mereka harus tahu betul supaya mereka ketika mengeluarkan peraturan menteri atau apapun tidak bertentangan dengan apa yang sudah kita ratifikasi dari hukum internasional ini. Ini penting sekali ya. Jadi mudah-mudahan Anda nanti sebagai lulusan UNPAD para ahli hukum laut. Ya. Oke, okay. Next. Ini gimana sih ngilanginnya? Oops, sorry. Mana tadi? Tadi kita lagi. Oke. Nah, ini Ibu mengulangi lagi saja apa yang disebut di dalam pasal 33. So I'm only taking your necessary importance for this. That in the coastal state may exercise the control. Ya. Tadi disebutkan di dalam paragraf 1 to prevent and to punish in prevalence of all these things. And I give you some ideas about that. Okay, so actually, what are the rights of those people or those vessels that are not ours? They are foreign, jadi kapal-kapal asing dan sebagainya. Apa yang bisa mereka lakukan? What can they do in the contiguous zone? Itu dibagi in different activities. The first one is navigation, and there is also overflight, fishing, scientific research, the laying of cable. Actually, it's usually is with also pipelines, mining, and environment. If you look at Article 33 only, it doesn't really indicate all these activities. However, when you read a certain provisions, like I told you before, you really have to understand what is it really. Now, if you look at the contiguous zone from my previous maps, I was telling you about contiguous zone, the maximum measurement is 24 nautical miles from the baseline. And then it also overlaps with the exclusive economic zone. So if you look at it, the activities that was not regulated by Article 33 could also be additional to what is ruled by the exclusive economic zone. Because the contiguous zone, most of the activities within it are also maybe fall within the rules or the provisions regarding the exclusive economic zone or even some of them regarding the high seas. Yeah, this is the importance really to learn about the provision of certain convention or certain law or whatever it is. Now, if you look at the activity of navigation, you can indicate that navigation is a full right for any outside vessels. Which provision are you referring to? You can look at the 1982 UN Convention on Law of the Sea in Articles 58, and then also in Articles regarding the high seas, 87 through 115. Yeah, I'm trying for you here to make some notes to indicate the related provisions of 1982 convention. So you will understand why I put this in the contiguous zone. Because like I told you before, the contiguous zone in certain activities might be within the regulation regarding the exclusive economic zone, even the high seas. Like navigation outside the territorial sea is what kind of navigation? Outside the territorial sea. Remember, Anand?
Okay, let me see my notes first. Professor.
Pardon?
Let me see my notes first.
Now I'm asking you, what are the right of navigation within the contiguous zone? What does it fall into which provision of the 1982 convention? In your own thinking, in your own analysis.
I think this is about
it's about right of navigation.
Yes.
Kebebasan untuk berlayar.
Okay.
I'm referring to Article 58.
Okay.
If you remember the 1982 convention, where does it belongs to? Article 58. To which part of the 1982 convention?
To the EEZ part.
The EEZ part, okay. So if any fishing vessels want to navigate through the EEZ, is it allowable?
It is not allowable.
It's not allowable, why?
Because the sumber daya alam yang ada di dalam EEZ itu masuk ke dalam sovereign rights bagi coastal state, Prof.
I'm talking about navigation, not okay. The natural resources.
It is okay to pass on the in the contiguous zone as long as the boat doesn't do just navigates in that zone.
As long it goes and
tunduk kepada peraturan coastal state. No. To the provision of the UNCLOS.
Which one? Which part of UNCLOS?
I think I'm already read about this last night.
Okay. Probably today. I'm sorry, Bu Orin. I'm teaching the students to really understand when reading the provision of any rules or regulation in what type, be it convention, be it agreement, be it hukum, be it peraturan presiden, peraturan pemerintah, whatever, what does it really mean? That is why I'm telling you, I'm trying to help you by putting the certain related articles in order for you to look at it. If any foreign vessels want to navigate through the contiguous zone, I already make you confused by telling you that it is instead also part of the exclusive economic zone, can also be regarded as part of the high seas. That is why I indicate to you on the first line, on this slide, full rights if compatible with the 1982 convention. Which part of the 1982 convention compatible with the right of navigation through the contiguous zone? I indicated there are articles 58 that belongs to part that rules the exclusive economic zone, and articles 87 through 115 that belongs to the rules of the high seas. Those articles refer to some freedom of navigation. You can use freedom of navigation in the contiguous zone and the exclusive economic zone. And you rightly, Anand, have indicated if the vessel didn't do any fishing in the exclusive economic zone, for instance, that is not permitted. If doing any fishing, but if it only navigates, it's free. Okay, see how important it is and how pusing is ahli hukum laut. Yeah, because you really have to indicate why did Ibu Eti put Article 58? What is that rules for? And why did she also put 87 up to 115? That is also very important for you to know how it regulates the right to navigation. Because contiguous zone is outside the territorial sea. If you only think shortly, it is part of the high seas. But then you come, oh no, no, no. Right after the territorial sea is the exclusive economic zone. So you have to indicate any rules in that part. That is why I indicate here, you look at Article 58 and also 87 up to 115, which rules only the thing that is related to freedom of navigation. Itu ketentuan tentang laut lepas. 87 sampai 115 itu kebanyakan tuh mengatur tentang pelayaran bebas. Dan contiguous zone, as far as it is only pelayaran, not fishing, for instance, not infringement of customs, fiscal, immigration, or sanitary laws, it does belong to the freedom of the high seas. The same thing also applies in the rules on the exclusive economic zone, because it allows freedom of navigation, as long as it doesn't do any activities that is governed by exclusive economic zone. Can you guys understand this? Atau Ibu Eti ini bikin pusing kita nih?
I'm already got it, and thank you for the explanation, Prof.
Okay, thank you. I'm trying, you know, for you to understand, because actually, many people said, with hukum laut, you cannot earn anything with regard to gaji. Gak bisa cari duit pakai hukum laut. Yang banyak duit, hukum ekonomi. Sekarang apa namanya? That has something to do with...
TIKA.
The what?
TIKA, Bu. Not technology, information.
Ecology, information, and then...
cyber.
And, Any new things, you know, within the world of law, quite a lot. Please put the notes. Even in the law of the sea, there are so many developments that is very difficult to really, you know, overcome it. But okay, you're still studying what is the law of the sea. Okay, I'm not giving you any problem for that. Only indicates about that. Okay, and then the rules number two is that navigation through the contiguous zone is restricted by Article 33. I've already indicated to you about the prevention and punishment of infringements to custom, fiscal, immigration, and sanitary laws and regulation. So any coastal states may board and search a vessel that is carrying out the activity of navigation only to prevent and punish infringement of Article 33. Only for that. Any other, you cannot do it. Okay? And then I was telling you about the removal of historical object, ya, penggalian apa namanya benda-benda historis, apa namanya bahasa Indonesia itu
purbakala atau
purbakala ya namanya benda purwakala itu kalau Anda melakukan pelayaran di situ di contiguous zone, kebetulan di dasar lautnya ada benda-benda purwakala yang menarik perhatian Anda, Anda harus minta izin dari negara pantai. Itu apa di mana? Bukan di aturan tentang contiguous zone, bukan di aturan tentang exclusive economic zone, bukan tentang ICES, tapi tentang benda purwakala. Pasal 303. Ya, buat ibu tadi siapa namanya yang S2, ini penting sekali. Dalam menulis tesis nanti bisa lari ke pasal-pasal yang terkait ini untuk melihat actually what is the rule of 1982 convention regarding navigation. Di sini kita sedang berbicara tentang kebebasan berlayar, the freedom of navigation. Ini belum diajarkan ya ICES, Bu Korin? ICES belum. Nanti belum jadi sampai. dalam ICES itu 87 to 100 something itu nanti related to 300, 200, quite a lot of things. Ya. Nah, overfly, lintas penerbangan itu bebas. Silahkan aja ayo mau terbang. Tidak ada aturan-aturan dari coastal state yang menghalangi orang-orang melakukan penerbangan di atas coastal zone. Di atas contiguous zone. Bukan coastal ya. Boleh aja terbang di sana. Perikanan dibatasi oleh aturan tentang EEZ. Yeah, because for the exclusive economic zone, later on I'll show you that you will see what are the rules. Bu Arin, actually how long do we still have now?
Maximum 1:30, Bu. So we still have like 1 hour if you still have energy.
Okay. Oh yes, I do.
Thank you.
Even though it's very hot here in Muscat, yeah. So I'm using air conditioning in my room. It's very very hot. Okay, fishing jadi ada aturannya dengan EEZ, tapi boleh juga di contiguous zone dilakukan berdasarkan ketentuan tentang EEZ yang diatur di pasal 62. Itu yang ada kaitannya dengan negara-negara landlocked states dan geographically disadvantaged states. Di situ mereka boleh fishing di atas contiguous zone asal itu ada izin dari negara yang sudah mengklaim zona ekonomi eksklusif. Pusing ya hukum laut ya. Melakukan sesuatu you can do this except if. You cannot do that because you are this. That is how important it is, you know, to be a lawyer. Okay. Scientific research ini diatur di dalam pasal 246. Tetap di sana ada semacam izin atau ketidakberatan dari negara pantai bahwa scientific research akan dilakukan di contiguous zone apabila negara itu sudah mengklaim exclusive economic zone. Karena contiguous zone sendiri tadi Anda lihat di pasal 33 tidak mengatur tentang scientific research. Scientific research justru diatur di dalam pasal yang berkaitan dengan zona ekonomi eksklusif. Oke. Okay. Borin, ini membingungkan enggak buat anak-anak?
Kayaknya caranya, ini lebih enak Bu ini dikasih apa tabel seperti ini. I think it's okay. Easier. I think.
Okay. Because ibu already knows me since I started becoming a docent, I don't like to give a ceramah. Yeah, ibu already knows that maybe I was, you know, against the custom or whatever of the law school. I don't stand in front or sit on my chair in front. Like now, I have to do this because all these electricity things have to be close to me. Yeah? But that I'm in class, saya suka jalan-jalan. Why? Karena mahasiswa yang duduk di belakang suka tidur. Jadi ibu bangunkan. Gitu ya. Ibu Orin mungkin nggak tahu, pernah ngalamin nggak? Waktu mau kuliah di kelas ibu minta mahasiswa untuk merubah tempat duduknya bukan berjejer-jejer, tapi jadi bunderan, jadi saling melihat. Supaya apa semua, give some interest in the kuliah. Okay, that's scientific research. Then there is also the freedom of the seas. any country may lay cable or pipelines in any part of the sea, whether it is the territorial sea of a state, you can lay cable and pipelines, except if this is coastal state have some rules, especially regarding with what do you call it, the arus, ya, arahnya kemana dan sebagainya. Itu ada negara yang mengatur karena mereka takut kalau negara-negara ini melaksanakan salah satu kebebasan yang diberikan oleh Law of the Sea Convention, yaitu laying of cable and pipelines, itu dilarang melakukan di satu daerah. Karena apa? Dia di situ kebetulan punya alat-alat, misalnya sedang mengadakan penambangan di dasar laut atau apa. Jangan sampai letakan dari cable dan pipelines ini akan mengganggu. Dulu ada satu, mungkin anak-anak ini mahasiswa ini mungkin belum lahir, ibu sudah jadi dosen, itu ada gempa bumi ya yang masuk di perairan dekat Vietnam. Dampak dari gempa bumi ini ternyata mengganggu cables untuk communication. Jadi kita nggak bisa buka Yahoo apa segala macam, itu tertutup berapa hari, nggak tahu Bu Olin ngalamin ya. Waktu itu ibu tuh sampai apa, biasanya selalu dengan email gitu dengan teman-teman yang sama satu ini jurusan, nggak bisa beberapa hari karena adanya cable yang untuk communication itu terganggu oleh gempa bumi waktu itu. Jadi bukan nyalahin Allah, enggak, tapi ya kok alat yang segini modernnya gitu ya. Sebetulnya dibilang modern juga tidak, karena pengaturannya masih sampai hari ini tahun 1800. Cable and pipelines itu. Ya sudah beberapa kali diseminarkan, tapi belum ada yang mencoba untuk mengaturnya lebih baik, karena dari perusahaan-perusahaan yang biasa mengatur atau taking care of the cable and pipelines itu, mereka mempertanyakan kenapa belum ada perubahan aturan sedangkan teknologi sudah makin maju. So I really don't know why it is like that. Yeah. Okay, mining no rights at all. Yeah. Ini ada aturannya di Continental Shelf, Article 76. Lalu environment, all states must observe, karena ini ada kaitannya tadi dengan sanitary rules. I'm talking about fish and dogs and everything. And then also, ini dimanapun in the ocean, wherever it is, part 12 of the 1982 Convention is applicable because it deals with prevention of pollution. Yeah, it applies anywhere, whether it is part of your territory or it is part outside of your territory, all the provisions regarding this marine environment is applicable. Okay? Bu Orin, yeah, you can see from the way I teach, only contiguous zone is more than 1 hour. Okay? Do we need any stop in between this or not? Shall we just continue?
Just continue.
Continue. Okay. Now let's move to, even though there is a contiguous zone in that, but it is called the exclusive economic zone. Okay. This is how it was mapped by so many mapping publisher, which I don't really understand because it only indicates the color of the countries and everything and how the sea, most of it are covered to become the exclusive economic zone. Okay, what is the exclusive economic zone? It is part of the high seas beyond and adjacent to the territorial sea, which shall not extend beyond the 200 nautical miles, the same as the contiguous zone measured from the baselines of the territorial sea, already indicated in the map of the maritime zone. No, jadi the baseline is the same, so everybody is using the baseline that you use to measure the territorial sea, and then you can measure the contiguous zone, you can measure the exclusive economic zone, and later on measure the continental shelf for that. So for the exclusive economic zone, it's like this. Actually, there is the history of it. but it is not part of the 1982 convention, but this is only the history. Why is there any drive toward establishing the inclusive economic zone? Actually, it relates to the years when the United States claimed the continental shelf after the Second World War in 1945. Yeah, it was the first one through their famous president, Truman, claim their jurisdiction, not claiming as part of the territory of the continental shelf beyond their territorial sea. Now, when USA did that, many countries followed them because USA was very, very regarded as the highest country in the world. I don't know today, you know, with the Ukraine and everything. Maybe Biden is not that listened to everybody. Anyway, at that countries followed what the Truman Proclamation did. However, here again, like I said, if you study the law of the sea, you have to know about geology. What is the continental shelf? At that time, is that the continuous seabed and subsoil from the territorial sea all the way to the high seas. And that is what Truman did. Many countries can do that, including Indonesia. But so many countries cannot do it. Why? Because we have a pantai curam. So it was not a pantai landai. They can have, according to geology, a landas continent. Which country did this movement toward claiming the sea for economic reasons? Because continental shelf at the time was believed to be quite a lot of economic reason also. Because the oil, which is the natural resources, was very important during World War II, also could be found in many parts of the continental shelf. And that is why they claim that the coastal states should have at least, not claiming as a territory, but a jurisdiction toward obtaining all the natural resources within the continental shelf. Now, since many countries cannot do that because of the formation of each beach, I can tell you a story that claimed by three countries in the Latin America. I put it here under the map, Chile, Peru, and Ecuador. The three countries made some movement by claiming their, actually not making territory, most of them, only some jurisdiction on certain economic reasons. Yeah? They cannot claim any continental shelf because of their natural situation. They look at it and the water, which is about 200 nautical miles from their baseline or from their beach, there is a kind of bird that called huano. Yeah, I don't know what is Bahasa Indonesia for huano. But anyway, this huano depends on their lives toward what they can get from the sea. In the sea, within the beach of Chile, Ecuador, and Peru, they present a current, a warm current called the Humboldt. Within the Humboldt current, there are natural resources that's called anchovies, you know, small fisheries, thousands of them. I don't have any good pictures, so I just put this picture I can find about anchovies. That they depend their life on their consumption of plankton. Plankton is also, you know, type of I would call natural resources also, but different things, you know, in there. That is the consumption of anchovies, and anchovies itself is the consumption of guano. So guano depend their life on eating anchovies. Anchovies depend themselves on plankton. Both anchovies and planktons depend on Humboldt current. At that time, the Humboldt current occurred only within 200 nautical miles. So Chile, Ecuador, and Peru went through the Association of Latin American Countries and insist that they are going to claim their jurisdiction toward this water, which is 200 nautical miles from their beach. And they give this reason. The guano actually give some means of living to all the people of Chile, Ecuador, and Peru. Why? This bird, guano, did not recognize the sea as their kamar mandi. So they want to go to kamar mandi. They went back to the land area. Ya. Jadi mereka buang kotorannya di sana. Ternyata Tuhan memberi kepandaian kepada manusia di Chile, Ecuador, dan Peru. Si kotoran guano ini ternyata bisa dijadikan apa namanya? Bahasa Indonesianya apa sih namanya?
Makanan, pakan.
Bukan makanan. What do you call? Kalau untuk tanaman itu apa?
Pupuk, Bu.
Pupuk. Sorry. I've only been in Muscat for 3 weeks. I already forget pupuk. Okay, they can be used, you know, as pupuk. And the pupuk, there are so many countries need it. So Chile, Ecuador, and Peru has an income by selling this pupuk. And this pupuk can be produced if guano is still protected. How do they protect them? By claiming jurisdiction toward where guano live between land and the sea. Kalau kata Pak Mohtar, kesatuan kehakiki antara hidup di darat dan di laut, katanya. Dari burung guano yang memberikan masukan atau income kepada Chile, Ecuador, dan Peru. So, tiga negara ini mengklaim they have jurisdiction toward this water yang ternyata apa namanya keadaan alamiahnya memberikan bantuan bagi mereka untuk melaksanakan kehidupan rakyatnya juga. Nah, ini tidak ada di dalam aturan Geneva Convention tahun 58 maupun aturan-aturan zaman tahun 30-an mulai ada Law of the Sea on the Territorial Sea dan sebagainya. Nah, ini kemudian dibawa oleh mereka ke konferensi negara-negara Amerika Latin dan negara Amerika Latin yang involved dengan beberapa negara di tempat lain juga menawarkannya ke Asia Afrika, ya di kalau nggak salah di Bombay atau di New Delhi di India, mereka perkenalkan ini dan juga ke Asosiasi Negara-Negara Afrika, sehingga negara-negara ini yang dulu mungkin memikirkan mereka tidak bisa melakukan seperti Amerika mengklaim continental shelf, mereka mengikuti apa yang dilakukan oleh Chile, Ecuador, dan Peru dengan mengklaim perairan yang kebetulan yang diklaim oleh Chile, Ecuador, dan Peru itu apa namanya lebarnya itu hanya sampai 200 mil laut. Ya, karena itu memberikan apa namanya dukungan kepada kehidupan mereka. Nah, ini kemudian diperkenalkan ke berbagai forum tadi sampai akhirnya masuk di konferensi persiapan konferensi hukum laut ketiga sebagai usulan adanya satu apa namanya klaim yang bisa dilakukan oleh negara-negara untuk bisa mengklaim satu zona maritim yang didasarkan pada kepentingan ekonomi. That is why it is called the exclusive economic zone. Ya. Nah, jadi di untuk hak negara-negara di exclusive economic zone, 1982 UN Convention made a different provision which is applicable to the coastal states that has claimed the exclusive economic zone and also to other states which are allowable to do some kind of activities within the exclusive economic zone that has been claimed by other states. Yeah, you can look at the 1982 convention starting I think article 56 if I'm not mistaken. Yeah, what are the rights they have? Especially if you look at the coastal states, it has the right, yang tadi oleh Arifanya sudah disebutkan, sovereign rights over the natural resources. Bukan sovereignty. Yeah? The sovereign rights on the natural resources, tapi beside that, untuk bisa melaksanakan haknya ini juga diberi jurisdiction to the establishment and use of artificial islands, because you know some activities within the sea sometimes you need artificial islands or platform or whatever. So the in the establishment and use of artificial islands, installation and structures. That is why in learning the law of the sea, you have to know what is actually artificial island, what is actually installation at sea, and other can be called as structures on the sea. Ya, tidak sama dengan di darat kan? Ada rumah gubuk dari bambu, ada rumah beton. Sekarang ibu nggak tahu apalagi namanya rumah-rumah bikinan sekarang. Ya. Cuma orang sudah makin pintar. And then also the coastal state within the exclusive economic zone has jurisdiction to govern the marine scientific research. Because you know, knowledge about the sea, even though today everybody has been so developed, so knows quite a lot of things. Indonesia, yang anak wawasan Nusantara, belum semua jadi orang laut. Ya, tidak tahu banyak. Hukum laut datangnya dari Bandung, Pak Mohtar Kusuma Atmaja. Yang ngikutin Ibu Eti, Pak Gusman dari Bandung juga orang gunung. Nah, ibu suka diledekin oleh kedutaan Amerika. Satu malam diundang untuk dinner di rumahnya. Terus ditanya, "Where are you from, madam?" Said, "I'm from Bandung." "Which university?" "Oh, Pajajaran University." "What are you teaching?" "I'm teaching the law of the sea." "What?" Dia bilang. "You're from the Bandung, up in Banten, and you're teaching about the sea? How do you know about the sea?" "Ya saya joking aja lah, niru si kebayan." Saya bilang, "From the Falcon, the tangkuban perahu, I can see the sea better than those people who live in Jakarta." Itu joke saya kepada the ambassador. Mereka bilang, "Oh, okay, I heard that Pajajaran," katanya, "apa, this Sam," katanya, "apa, dibilangnya orang pinter." "Ya, yeah, but I'm only," saya bilang, "good at joking. But you can accept that," saya bilang. "At least I know all about the regulation on the law of the sea, even though I live in Bandung," bilang gitu ya. Jadi waktu itu memang yang ahli hukum laut Pak Mohtar kan di Bandung, rumahnya sebelum pindah ke Tuku Angkasa ke mana lagi itu, daerah timur itu ya. Nah, oke. Okay. Jadi di sini mereka bisa establish, jadi mendirikan artificial islands, installation and structures. And they can also govern, jadi mengatur tentang marine scientific research. And ibu kata di bagian dari laut, the protection and preservation of the marine environment. Itu tiga hal yang masuk ke dalam jurisdiksi, yang masuk ke dalam sovereign rights adalah anything yang dalam pelaksanaan the sovereign rights over natural resources. What about state? Ibu kata zone can also be of the high seas. Pun dikenal bagi others, the free refer to article on the high seas. That is next. And then the laying of communication and open and laying of submarine cables and pipe. Itu kan dibenarkan mention on the law of the sea. Actually, the exclusive economic zones is part of the maritime zones when teaching on the law of the one class khusus, yeah. Because let's look now at the right of culture in the because it deals with the sovereign rights on the natural resources. It does resources. So this one is this as getting to non the artificial islands. I look at this, the management is very important because natural resources, like I said, to get what is called now today a sustainable availability to all the human beings. So it has to be managed. And so there are rules regarding fishing, regarding how to protect the non-living resources and how the establishment of artificial islands that not hurt any living environment or the marine environment. And here I also put the articles that is referred to those things. Like for instance, with fishing, which is belong to the living resources, there are also certain rules to the sedentary species. That is a species that in their life does not only swimming, but also have a touch with the seabed. Yeah. If I'm not mistaken, apa namanya, udang itu shrimp. Yeah. And then, what is the big word, the big shrimp?
Lobster.
Lobster. Okay. Sorry, students. I'm already nearing 79, so I start forgetting some names, yeah? And I have to be able to get some assistance from Ibu Klorin to remember this. Ibu Klorin is still young. Okay, and then also in the non-living resources, even though in the article, paragraph 3 of the, I think article 56, yeah, paragraph 3, it was indicated that any rules or any regulation on the non-living resources shall be put under the law of the continental shelf. Because the seabed and subsoil, which is beneath the water column of the exclusive economic zone, falls into the continental shelf regulation. Okay. So I try to look at it on how if activities is done, what are the regulation involved with it, and how would it give any effect to the rights of the coastal state? I try to put this and look at the related articles. You can learn from it too. Okay. This is a right of the coastal states. And then, okay. Within the exclusive economic zone, activities mostly concerned with the utilization of the natural resources, both living and non-living. When we speak about living resources, mostly people deal with fishing. And apparently within the fishing management, there are quite a lot of things that is regulated under the 1982 convention. If you look at it, I try to indicate the articles that are related to conservation, you know, the protection so that the living resource there can we use the terminology suspendable, you know, the continuation, and then also on the management, how to optimize the utilization of the living resources, the distribution and accommodation of the living resources, so almost everybody can get the rights to it, and then the settlement of dispute, because there are still quite a lot that possible conflicts or future conflicts regarding the exclusive economic zone these days. And then how are the regulation and implementation of this rule? Now, when we speak about conservation, what are the rules within the 1982 convention? First, the coastal state that has claimed the EEZ should establish what they call the total allowable catch. Here you have to learn the biology, fisheries biology. How can you still sustain the availability of the fish by using the measurement of total allowable catch? How can you catch the fish allowable in your exclusive economic zone so you still can suspend its existence in the future? There are rules on it in biology, of course. There are rules, the percentage. If I'm not mistaken, Indonesia used the percentage that the total allowable catch is around 60% of whatever is available within our EEZ. And then what are the steps for conservation that is very important? So you have to collect the data, the scientific evidence. In Indonesia, it is very difficult because we have too many species of fish. I don't know how many, maybe more than 100, could be 1,000. Quite a lot of type of fish in here. Yeah, I remember I had some joking fighting with my friend from Australia because the Australian claim that ikan kakap is Australian. I told him, even my great-grandmother provide me on the dinner table with kakap. So it is Indonesian fish. See how difficult it is in order to indicate where is the snapper is usually from. Even here in Muscat, they don't have any snapper in their ocean, in the Gulf of Oman. But you can still buy ikan kakap at the swap shop. Yeah, so it is everywhere. And then also you have to try to do some management to decide the maximum sustainable yield. What is the maximum sustainable yield? How do you expect that it will still be available for you to catch? And because a fish really probably is a very worldwide traveler, they will go anywhere. Ikan tuna from Indonesia might go to Atlantic, going through South Africa, maybe stop in Cape Town to have some fun first, and then go to Atlantic. And then some tuna fish might born in near Bali, but they travel all the way to Australia and becoming greater and greater. Yeah, the what do they call it? Black, I don't know, anyway type of tuna near Australia and Indonesia, Banda, etc. It's very, very good. Yeah.
Blue thin and tuna, then, tuna bukan, Bu?
Kenapa?
Is it blue thin tuna dolphin?
Bluefin, yes. Bluefin. Yes. Thank you. The bluefin and the yellowfin. Yeah, yellowfin tuna. Itu, I remember my own experience. I was... Well, as a docent fakultas hukum, sometimes I was asked by Ministry of Foreign Office, Kemlu, to do something that they don't have anybody to do it. I had to travel to a certain area that is called the, how do they call it? Vanuatu Islands. Anybody know where that is? Vanuatu Islands is further east of Australia. You can go there. And in there is quite a lot of fishing markets. And the bluefin and can be found there, of course, because Australia. But the yellowfin can only be found in Indonesia. But at that time, one of the fishermen could found one yellowfin that is as big as, what do they call it? Yeah, the biggest truck. Ya, almost 500 kilo kali beratnya at that time. And since I was visiting there, one of them are Indonesian, the worker at the nelayan, and they said, "Ibu, would you like to come? I will give you some dinner from tuna." So I went there, and you know, the way I look at it, oh, if I have this much fish, I can give it not only to the whole Rukun Warga, but probably to the whole city of Bandung. Like I said, it's 500 kilograms. Very big, so it had to be carried by a very long truck. That is how international cooperation is very important when you want to measure or to manage fishing. Beside of conservation, how you should do it for tuna, how you do it with a snapper or any other type of fish, is exchange of information available, and how we do with the international organization. Excuse me, let me drink first. Okay. In management, there are also other things that you need to carry out. In utilization, you have to establish the capacity to harvest. And also, if you cannot utilize the whole harvest that is available for you, meaning there is a surplus that you cannot really use it or utilize it, you have to make it open as a surplus for any other states to use it. But it is regulated by the 1982 convention. For Indonesia, which is considered to be a developing country, not developed country like America, you have to look at the rights for landlocked states and geographically disadvantaged states. There are some countries that doesn't have any beach, they don't border with any sea. And then geographically disadvantaged states are those who are geographically, they didn't have any long beach. So access to the sea is very short, yeah. And then also the coastal states that have already claimed established the exclusive economic zone has the power to set up the terms, conditions, law, and regulation for this utilization. For instance, I don't know how whether it is applicable in the land of fishing. When you want to catch a certain type of fish, you are only allowed to catch up to a maximum weight. So if you catch smaller ones, you have to bring it back to its origin, not to really catch it. So to let them grow, and then later on, you can get it as already being grown, okay? Now in the distribution and accommodation of all the living resources in the EEZ, you can do it through, like I said, the utilization of surplus, and then how you are regulating this. There is one thing that you have to really take notes within the EEZ regulation. Anybody who want to use the surplus has look at the status of that state. If it is a developed state, they cannot ask the use of surplus from developing states. They have to look again at other developed states. Yeah, that is some kind of effort by the law of the Sea Convention in to give distribution and accommodation equally. Yeah. And then, okay. For the law enforcement of the coastal state, it has the right to regulate a lot of things that is dealing with fishing and any other use of natural resources. And then any violation of the coastal state regulation cannot be punished by imprisonment. It can only be done by deciding the fine. Ya, hanya dengan denda, jadi tidak ditawan gitulah ya. Nah, saya nggak tahu waktu Ibu Susi jadi menteri yang ditangkap itu kapalnya apakah ada yang di EZ atau hanya ada di perairan sekitar Pangandaran ya, kampungnya Bu Susi, atau di sekitar Banda mana gitu. Itu banyak malah di situ kapalnya yang dihancurkan, bukan si nelayan-nelayannya yang involved dalam hal itu ditarik gitu ya. Ditahan, kemudian diwajibkan negaranya untuk mengambil mereka. Jadi kita pulangkan, bukan atas biaya kita. dibiaya oleh negara-negara tersebut. Agak susah sekali ini. Kalau Australia yang saya tahu, mereka memberikan satu yang banyak ditangkap nelayan Indonesia kalau di Australia itu ya. Nah itu mereka mengadakan semacam bantuan untuk mengembalikan nelayan-nelayan yang dianggap melanggar peraturan, yaitu dengan memulangkannya ke wilayah yang terdekat dari Australia, yaitu Bali. Karena kalau ada ingin travel ke Australia dengan murah itu naiknya dari Denpasar. Ya bukan dari Bandung. Kalau dari Bandung mungkin mahal karena flight-nya kan additional hour gitu ya. Nah, ini law enforcement-nya yang agak susah di sini, yaitu kalau kita kebetulan menangkap violation yang dilakukan oleh nelayan-nelayan asing di zona ekonomi eksklusif, jangankan di zona ekonomi eksklusif. Di perairan Nusantara aja, di perairan kepulauan, itu kita ngejarnya nggak bisa. Itu kapal-kapal nakal seperti dari Taiwan, dari China, dari mana itu, mereka pintar-pintar ngumpet dan menggunakan peralatan-peralatan vessel yang lebih cepat larinya daripada kapal-kapal apa namanya tuh yang authority di laut kita mengejarnya. Ya, yang banyak terjadi juga misalnya di sekitar Natuna itu di utara itu kan itu zona ekonomi eksklusif Indonesia, tapi sebagian juga diklaim oleh China. Jadi kita tangkap nelayan Cina yang masuk ke situ, sesudah itu kita pulangkan ya sesuai dengan aturan. Taunya si penangkap ini yang mencoba memulangkan malah ditangkap oleh tentara Cina karena mereka anggap itu ZTE-nya. Dan itu terus itu. Jadi sekarang kalau dilihat apa namanya itu possible conflicts di South China Sea itu yang paling bermusuhan itu adalah Cina dengan berbagai negara ya. Oke. Okay. Nah, kalau terjadi konflik, terjadi permasalahan, persengketaan, maka settlement of dispute itu tidak menentukan forum pengadilan mana yang harus mereka datangi. Ya, jadi tidak ada compulsory procedure itu. Mereka boleh milih mau caranya bagaimana dengan cara apa gitu lah ya. Nah, kemudian namanya kalau tidak ada cara penyelesaian perkara, maka diadakan prosedur konsiliasi. Ini bukan suatu kewajiban, tapi bisa dilakukan apabila yang dirasa membuat suatu kesalahan itu justru negara pantainya. Karena dia tidak melakukan conservation measures. Dia tidak menentukan total allowable catch. Dia menolak penggunaan surplus oleh negara-negara, misalnya kalau ada yang begitu ya. Yang saya tahu Indonesia melakukan itu mungkin dengan tidak selalu benar gitu. Ada waktu-waktunya dulu tuh yang saya ingat memberi kesempatan itu justru ke negara-negara maju seperti Jepang, Korea gitu ya. Padahal harusnya kita hanya beri ke Bangladesh gitu atau ke apalah negara-negara kecil ya. That is what happening in our exclusive economic zone. Oke, okay. Ini hanya sedikit gambaran tentang fisheries management ya. Apa yang dilakukan itu adalah mengenai mengasosiasikan stock dan species, kemudian jenis-jenis highly migratory, lalu jenis-jenis apa disebutnya tuh marine mammals itu yang menyusui kan, lalu ada yang disebut anadromous dan catadromous species. Lalu ada sedentary species. Itu aturan-aturannya ada dan bisa melibatkan negara ketiga atau organisasi internasional. Ini salah satu rules di dalam exclusive economic zone yang paling penting untuk diperhatikan oleh negara-negara yaitu fishery management ini. Karena ini dianggap akan terus mensuspend di allowable catch-nya. Bagaimana Indonesia menerapkannya? Kita punya dulu cepat sekali tahun 83 kita mengeluarkan undang-undang nomor 5 tentang ZTE Indonesia. Nah, ini kalau Ibu baca ya sebagai seorang mahasiswa waktu itu Ibu tampaknya beberapa peraturan itu dalam pasal-pasal itu seperti terjemahan saja dari apa yang ada di 1982 Convention on the Law of the Sea. Ternyata di dalam pelaksanaannya masih banyak yang harus kita lakukan, yang harus kita perhatikan kembali sebagai negara yang mengklaim exclusive economic zone, aturan-aturan apa yang belum betul-betul kita apa namanya tuh keluar aturannya gitu ya. Karena pengertian tentang exclusive economic zone ini supaya Ibu katakan tadi banyak petugas itu yang tidak mengerti. Ada yang menganggap exclusive economic zone itu adalah part of the sovereignty. Jadi dia mengeluarkan aturannya inginnya segala dibatasi ini itu dan sebagainya. Padahal kalau kita lihat di dalam aturan 1982 UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, within the EEZ itu fisheries management have required us very compulsory tentang management of fisheries. Yang kita tidak bisa membuat pembatasan-pembatasan yang tidak ada kaitannya dengan the suspendability of the fishery catch gitulah ya. Sebetulnya ibu tuh inginnya juga menunjukkan adanya perkembangan ya. Baru tadi pagi ini hanya sedikit aja nanti Anda bisa pelajari dari Law Number 31 of 2004 tentang perikanan yang ternyata telah dirubah pada tahun 2009 oleh Undang-Undang Nomor 45. Ini hanya merubah beberapa pasal yang ada di dalam pasal 3.1. Ibu coba untuk memberi summary, tapi not so ini ya, not so perfect lah kalau menurut ibu kerjaan ibu ini. Ibu yang lihat itu bahwa di Undang-Undang Nomor 3.1/2004 there are some weaknesses di dalam aturan-aturannya ini, terutama yang ada kaitan dengan fisheries management serta tindakan-tindakan pidana di bidang perikanan. Ya, banyak sekali itu kan, seperti misalnya benih-benih ikan dari Indonesia itu bisa lari ke luar negeri, kemudian jadi ada di mana dan sebagainya ya. Sebagai orang akademisi, ibu suka ikut international seminar itu pernah mengalami diketawakan oleh delegasi dari Taiwan. Oh, katanya Eddie Agus, katanya claim that Indonesia is very developed with regard to its attention on the law of the sea by establishing law on the exclusive economic zone and by claiming that you have many availability of fisheries. And then what do you have? The Taiwan asked me. I never see any fish in your area. Waduh, saya tuh terus terang aja ya bingung mau jawabnya gimana sambil sakit hati gitu dalam hati sih ya. Terus saya tanya, are you a fisherman? Have you ever traveled to Indonesia? What did you see in there? Terus dia balik tanya, why did you ask that? Well, I just want to know whether what you said, saya bilang, is something that you really find it yourself in our exclusive economic zone or any part of our sea within Indonesia. Okay, dia bilang, let's compare. What did you see? Saya bilang, I didn't see it, but I read about it, that many foreign fishermen that was caught by Indonesia are Taiwanese. Dan itu benar, ibu nggak bohong gitu ya, karena ibu diberitahu orang-orang Taiwan tuh suka curi ikan bu, katanya pinter mereka tuh gini gitu, ada yang bisa bahasa Indonesia segala macam. Okay, that is a fact gitu ya, meskipun ibu tidak cari apakah itu real fact atau hanya main-main saja. Dan si Taiwan tuh bilang, you're only an academician, Ati Agus. How can you know that? I'm a good friend of all those people who know the real data. Akhirnya dia diem. Saya padahal itu saya dengar kapal-kapal yang ditangkap itu selalu disebutnya kapal Cina ya, karena itu dari Taiwan. Taiwan dengan China kan it is difficult for you to really make a difference between them gitu ya, mungkin dalam bahasa agak beda gitu lah. Okay. Nah, jadi kalau kita lihat ya, Indonesia itu tidak hanya exclusive economic zone, tapi the fishing area itu menurut Kementerian Kelautan dan Perikanan itu dibagi ke dalam 11 daerah pemeliharaan perikanan. Kalau dulu hanya 9. Sekarang dirubah jadi 11. Jadi dalam peta ini yang saya dapat dari mereka ada warna-warna laut yang dibeda-beda, jumlahnya itu 11 ya. Jadi fisheries management-nya menurut aturan Indonesia itu masuk ke dalamnya Indonesian internal waters, archipelagic waters, and the territorial sea, and then also the land waters. It is difficult to indicate land waters, who are the land waters, because some areas have names of local names, yeah, that probably not very familiar to us about that. For instance, for rivers, lakes, reservoirs, and dams, and then water ponds, whatever it is called also as a part of the fisheries management area, and also the EEZ. Yeah? However, outside fisheries management area, also may be applicable to Indonesia, because we have a, what do you call it, fisheries that like to surround from one area, a certain country, to another country. Like I talk about tuna. Tuna is very worldwide traveling. You know, I mentioned to you, they were born as little babies near Bali. They can travel to Australia, but some or all of them can travel to Atlantic. I don't know how, but they are very, 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 very rich, the tuna fisheries area, yeah? Okay. On the law of number 45, there are some articles within law number 31 that has been dirubah, given additional fisheries authority to the Minister of Marine Affairs and Fisheries. Yeah, so there is quite a lot in here. You can look at law number 45 of 2009. I was trying to find out what is recent development. I only try to indicate, for instance, I mentioned to you, EEZ is a common source of conflicts. Look at the South China Sea. Ongoing disputes are mostly between China and other countries surrounding China, Taiwan, Vietnam, Philippines, Indonesia, like I said, near Natuna, and Malaysia. And then there are others in Adriatic Sea by Croatia. They have a friction with Italy and Slovenia. And then big countries, Canada and the US, is deputed on the Beaufort Sea, as the area reportedly contains of substantial oil reserves. And then Mauritius, a small country, has claims for certain islands and dispute with France, and also dispute with the United Kingdom. And then Turkey also has some difficulties with Cyprus, with regard of EEZ. Greece itself, Yunani, claims a continental shelf within the Aegean Sea, but being refused by Turkey. And then Greece also claim in other area that brings some conflicts with Libya and Turkey also, and also with Egypt. And then Lebanon also has some claim. And then Japan also with China, Taiwan, and South Korea. Yeah. How much of these conflicts or other conflicts being resolved? I only make some notes. I didn't have time to go through the outcome of some court decision with regard to this dispute on the EEZ before the famous EEZ, that is the Cold Wars between UK and Iceland in 1976. And then the famous one for the first EEZ case was between Canada and France, because two islands of France are very close to Canada, which is called the Saint-Pierre and Miquelon. Yeah, it gives Saint-Pierre and Miquelon certain areas, not very big as the EEZ of France, which is so far from Canada. Yeah, but it was given in there. And then also between Yemen and Eritrea in 1999, and then 2009, between now, which is still under war with Russia, Ukraine, and Romania, over the Snake Islands, and then Norway and Russia in 2010, both on territorial sea and EEZ, with regard to the what they call Svalbard Archipelago. And 2014, the Netherlands and Germany has resolved an old border dispute regarding the exact location of the border in the Dollar Bay. Yeah, this I don't know, Ibu Orin is in the case study. Are we doing any new cases or not?
Not yet, Bu, but I think I will give these new cases to be learned by the students to be presented next week to deepen the knowledge and understanding of the EEZ itself.
Okay, thank you. Okay, as far as I'm concerned, that is my oleh-oleh from Muscat. I hope I didn't add times for you before. This is Salat area, yeah? In Salat time in Bandung. So thank you very much. I hope I did give you some additional knowledge about the law of the sea. And then later, maybe you can talk to Ibu Orin, Pak Guzman, who else is teaching? Pak Idris?
Yes, Pak Idris.
Yeah, okay, Pak Idris also. With regard to all these things, because as far as I'm concerned, law of the sea, the development of it, how it was implemented, has been things that always discussed by the group of the ratifying islands. You know, the report of it is something will be very tiring to read because it can go to 300 pages or only 100 pages. Quite a lot of things, kind of dispute or kind of difficult application of the 1982 convention on certain areas within the sea. Okay, jadi itu saja oleh-olehnya, Bu Arin. Terima kasih masih dianggap pensiunan ini untuk bagi-bagi pengetahuannya. Thank you to Anan, Arifania, tadi siapa lagi? Banyak yang lupa namanya ya, dan yang peserta dari S2 mudah-mudahan dia tambah ilmunya.
Amin. Thank you very much.
Ya. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Thank you very much, Ibu. There are so many things you've shared with us. I believe in my positions as a student, I have a lot of things, a lot of knowledge. Ini kalau ini kan pas makan siangnya wareg banget gitu, Bu. Banyak ilmunya.
Sorry ya, waktu makan siangmu jadi ke ini keganggu.
It's okay, ya. Bu. Mm-mm. Kita kebetulan dapat jadwal tuh mata kuliah itu pas makan siang. Aduh, godaan banget ya, adik-adik ya. Jadi
sekarang begini, jam berapa di sana sekarang?
Sekarang setengah dua kurang 6 menit.
Oh, kalau setengah dua belum terlalu lapar.
Masih bisa dikasih sih.
Ya. Okay.
Ibu,
okay. Terima kasih. Ya.
Boleh ini mungkin mau memberi kesempatan jika ada yang mau bertanya nggak, Bu?
Oh ya, silakan kalau masih ada waktunya.
Kita masih punya sekitar 5 menit. Apakah ada yang mau? Waduh, banyak fansnya nih. Waduh. Boleh mungkin disampaikan dulu pertanyaannya, barangkali nanti jawabannya mungkin bisa di apa di
disatukan
gitu. Singkat padat jelas ya. Tadi saya lihat Ilham dulu deh, Ilham, Ravina sama Arifania, please.
Oke, terima kasih Ibu atas kesempatannya. Yang menjadi concern saya tadi di presentasi dari Prof. Eti itu ada EEZ common source of conflict. Yang saya pengen tanyakan itu kenapa kalau saya lihat itu penyelesaian delimitasi EEZ itu lebih sukar dibanding penyelesaian di landas kontinen. Bukan kalau kita lihat kalau kita dengan Malaysia itu di Selat Malaka kan landas kontinen sudah sepakat, tapi kenapa EEZ-nya itu tidak kunjung sepakat gitu. Terima kasih, Bu, kesempatannya.
Oke, terima kasih Ilham. Ravina, silakan pertanyaannya apa?
Terima kasih, Bu. Okay, untuk pertanyaan ini mungkin lebih apa ya, pertanyaan konyol gitu, Bu. Cuman ini penasaran aja gitu, Bu. You've mentioned before that the coastal states can set their limit of the territorial sea less than 12 nautical miles. Then if there exists the coastal state that they limit the territorial sea less than 12 miles, I just want to ask that what are they considered to set less than 12 nautical miles? Because
I assume... sorry, Revina. I didn't really catch it. I don't know the communication.
Oh yeah.
Can you just shorten it? Okay.
Okay.
What is the question?
The question is, what are the reason for the coastal states that set their territorial sea less than 12 nautical miles if there is exist the coastal state that did that things, Prof. And is there any, in your opinion, is there any kelebihan atau keuntungan untuk si negara itu ngeset kurang dari 12 nautical miles tadi? Ini mungkin silly question, tapi saya lumayan penasaran gitu, Prof, dengan fakta di lapangannya gimana. Okay. Terima kasih, Prof.
Okay. Anybody else? Only two person?
Yes, ma'am. Safa. Please, Arifan, ya, Safa.
Thank you for the opportunity. So I would like to ask specifically about a policy that we used to applicate. It's about penenggelaman kapal illegal fishing that we used to applicate. So I would like to ask your opinion whether you are agree with that policy or not. And in your opinion, is that policy effective in solving the infringements of illegal fishing in Indonesia? Maybe that's all from me. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you, Ibu Mangga, silakan.
Terima kasih. Okay. Tadi dari Ilham itu pertanyaannya tentang source of conflicts mengenai landas kontinen dan EEZ boundary. Was it with Malaysia? Kalau saya nggak salah tangkap. Di mana Ilhamnya?
Ilham.
Iya, Prof, benar.
Dan tentang itu ya. Jadi yang Ibu ikuti ya, waktu Ibu belum pensiun, Ibu masih suka ikuti bantu Kemlu. Permasalahan dalam batas-batas zona maritim dengan Malaysia ini adalah kita belum sampai kepada perdebatan antara petugas yang ini yang ditugasi untuk itu gitu ya. Ini baru masalah teknis. Jadi yang masih berbicara banyak adalah sebagai saya lihat tuh mungkin saya salah ya, seolah-olah ini bisa untuk lambat dia terlalu terlibat. Anggota-anggota yang decision making instansinya dalam hal perdebatan kita mengenai landas ini dengan Malaysia, dan ini